Good evening and welcome to Africa News Network First Fast Live. My name is Cindy Mabi. Now, as the world marks International AIDS Day, a survey reveals shocking statistics of infection prevalence due to a drop in condom use. With the government's prevention strategy to abstain, promote monogamy and condom use, a staggering 40% of young people are ignoring this message, leading to the risk of being exposed to sexually transmitted infections. The campaign to have South Africans accept the use of condoms as one of the basic requirements to halt HIV prevalence in the country, among other sexually transmitted diseases, seems to be a huge challenge. A latest South African demographic and health survey has proven that South Africans still abhor the use of condoms, and the survey shows an inadequate condom use is reported to be at 58% among women and 65% among men.
It constitutes a crisis for us. If the rate at which new infections are happening amongst young women and girls constitute a crisis, and we have looked at everything. So the plan, the Gauteng 5-year strategic plan that we are going to launch today, the main plank and thrust of that is to reach these young women. That's why you see. But we also want to reach young boys, because without bringing them on board, it will be difficult for the young women to negotiate their way out of this. So our key target is the youth.
Of a generation, HIV/AIDS free generation is becoming a reality. Our concern, however, is in the age group of 15 to 29 years old, where we're seeing a high incidence of new infections. So today we are focusing on young people in general, especially young women. And that's why we are promoting our campaign of She Conquers, which is part and parcel of our Gauteng White program on focusing on young girls, empowering them and giving them a better opportunity.
And despite the alarming rate of HIV infections and the lack of condom use, government and civil society groups continue with their efforts to make condoms accessible and to encourage men to go for circumcision to lower sexually transmitted infections and to reduce the HIV prevalence in South Africa. Now, HIV-positive people in the country increased from an estimated 4.94 million in 2002 to 7.06 million by 2017. In 2017, an estimated 12.6% of the total population is living with HIV. And the report says approximately one-fifth of South African women in their reproductive ages between 15 and 49 years are HIV positive. However, HIV prevalence among the youth between 15 and 25 years declined from 7.3% in 2002 to 4.6% in 2017. And while the rate at which the population in South Africa is being infected is estimated to be declining from 1.9% in 2002 to 0.9% in 2017. And joining us live in studio, Criselda Dudumashe, media personality and wellness activist. Good evening to you and thanks for joining us. And Anele Siswana, clinical psychologist, joins us on our OB facility. Sfiso Mtsweni is with the NYDA, the National Youth Development Agency, as their executive chairperson. It's of course one of those days that I know over the years you felt it only becomes prominent.
Yeah.
You become the poster girl, so to speak. You're busy on the 1st of December because it's World AIDS Day. And we don't talk about it enough, about sexual behavior generally. Has your stance changed?
Well, my body can actually attest to that. Throughout the day today, it's been quite a busy day. And a busy day in rehashing and reiterating the same messages over and over again. You'll be amazed at how much ignorance is still out there. Stigma still exists. There are so many things that or myths that we have tried to dispel, but to date we're still dealing with exactly that.
And why is that? Are we not, you know, you'd say information is abundant, that we've become so liberal, we're able to speak to young people or even our children. The generation gap is somewhat being narrowed. Why is it that we still find it difficult to either behave differently with all this information around? Mr. Mtsweni.
Well, I think based on the stats that you just showed now, as much as the HIV and AIDS pandemic continues to grow, we're quite encouraged that amongst young people it's beginning to decline, particularly those between 15 and 24, which means that the message of government, particularly in schools and so on, is beginning to make some, you know, inroads. But I just want to come in quickly. You know, this issue of stigma, it's not reducing, it continues to go high. I don't know where the difficulty becomes between parents and kids actually talking about sex, because at the center of this is actually that particular conversation that I think at some point parents and children need to start being comfortable about.
And if you don't do it or speak to your children, somebody else will. I mean,
oh, absolutely.
Yeah. What has the role of social media, be it even television, music, or even, I know with certain porn sites, that South Africa are the biggest consumers of such. Is it just sexual immorality that is also contributing to this?
For me, it's not only about even access to social media. It's also looking at our socioeconomic environments, that you have homes where there's a family of seven in two rooms. There's no privacy. Kids are exposed to things that they're not supposed to be exposed to. That it's important that that conversation about sex and sexuality is held. As you rightfully indicate, that if you do not teach them yourself, someone else is doing it on your behalf. Mm. And unfortunately, there's someone, often than not, it's a person with interests that have nothing to do with advancing their child's development or even educating. It's always from a selfish point of view, and hence more and more of our children are exposed to explicit content that they're not supposed to be exposed to.
Mm. I mean, it's of course a myriad of situations that we find ourselves in. You at home are welcome to give us a call on 011-542-2186. It is PG-rated content, so if there are any young people of below the age of 16 watching, so we'd advise that you perhaps find something else for them to do. Anele Siswana, clinical psychologist, good evening to you, and thank you so much for joining us. We may not know the specific demographics when it comes to race or class and creed of why people generally don't use condoms, but it is a myth to assume that it's generally amongst the youth. What is your view to that?
It's a bit difficult because I don't know, as I say, I don't have the actual statistics, but I would be of the view that it goes across youth and adults. But mostly I'll be more aligned to say mostly the prevalence is much more around young people, particularly those ones between the ages of 18 and 24, as studies indicate that that's the most group that's most vulnerable and that often engages in unprotected sex.
The environment or the power dynamics within that sexual relationship amongst young people, we know of the blesser phenomenon or even culture, and the disparities, as you are saying, socioeconomic conditions where young people may find themselves in a position where they have to sell their bodies, literally. How much of that contributes to what we're seeing currently?
It is a growing concern because you look at higher education currently, the pressures that young people are faced with, we don't build character enough for them to make an informed decision to walk away from situation that would harm them. That when I look at Usindi in this beautiful environment, not looking at the fact that she works, I want to look like her, I want hair like hers, and because of those pressures, they end up making ill-informed decisions that end up harming them. And it's just... And most of the time we're focusing so much on the young woman who makes the decision, but the message is not as strong for the men who are perpetrators of this, for the men who are preying on these young girls. And I think we need male voices to just stand up and just be vocal and be heard, yeah. That not in our name and not in this time that we live in.
Yeah. And Mr. Mtsweni, do you think that even the research that has been done is almost done in silos? We're not contributing the fact that socioeconomic issues, the fact that people may want to solicit sex for whatever reason, there are predators involved, to come up with a national strategy that would work. What's your
view? Look, I agree firstly with Griselda on the issue of, you know, the conversation with a boy child. The socioeconomic impact on the girl child also becomes very important. Because I think there's one issue that I think at times we're not talking about. How do we create a conducive environment for the girl child to grow? Particularly as government, for instance, there's been a big issue around, you know, the biological reproductive system that faces young girls. We provide condoms everywhere. What about sanitary towels? You know, because these two go together. You have young girls that actually, you know, don't have even enough money to afford sanitary towels, and they fall prey to some of these blesser phenomenon. So yes, as much as let's have a conversation with the male guys, but at the same time, let's create a conducive environment for the girl child to be able to grow properly in that particular environment.
Perhaps we need to look at the impact of those kind of campaigns with the dignity packs and how far wide they reach. Mr. Siswana, just in the derogatory manner and objectification of women, growing up in the township in Guatemala Springs, I can tell you without any fear that there'd been numerous incidents of sexual harassment, be it in the name calling and all sorts of things. You know, how do we change that environment? Because these conditions still persist.
Let me rather start by saying and attributing to what Griselda and others is saying, that the problem begins with the ignorance and stigma that is attached to HIV and the misconception that then are attached to HIV and AIDS, that people have become desensitized to the knowledge and understanding about HIV and what HIV does. And so with that being an issue, people tend to be irresponsible because they feel that the information is not important, or the fact that there aren't as many probably opportunities that are there for them to find ways of negotiating that. At the same time, with regards to the campaign like voluntary male circumcision, those campaigns are very much important, but at the same time, it goes back to what he said, that if those campaigns are not done and actually advertised in a manner that promotes sexual reproductive health in a good way, we run into a risk of young boys and men perpetuating the infection, at the same time engaging in sexual practices because they would believe that they are circumcised whilst they are reinfecting themselves in a situation where others are infected. And now we're sitting with a situation where sex is commercialized, as Griselda mentioned, that young girls from the university, we have situations where these young girls have blessers and sugar daddies in finding ways of maintaining the social standards of university. So all of these factors contribute to factors that add a factor in the high rate of HIV and AIDS.
Mm. Stay on the line with us, please, Mr. Siswana. We have a caller, Tina from Pretoria. Good evening to you.
Good evening. A lady, I say, don't give girls drugs before they are 20 years old. Because they are young, they want to grow, and now they have kids, and they don't have safe sex because they want the kids. They want to have the grant. They want to get a grant.
All right.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much, Tina. I don't know if that's had been scientifically proven that indeed there is the tendency to fall pregnant because you want to access social grants, and the more children you have, you then multiply your income.
It's a very difficult situation to acknowledge, Cindy, because those of us who are on the ground, we hear those, but there's no data to support it, that you would hear government often saying it's not proven. But we know there are conversations, and hence, terminology like imali eqolo. It comes from such notions where people would say, mangina three, then I calculate that how many kids are going to have access to a grant. The opportunity then becomes, how do we empower South Africans that even in accessing grants, you regard it as a means, an end to a means, where you are going to even look at that as a way of setting up your own business, finding ways of using the grant money to empower yourself. But instead, there are many people within the system that are abusing the grant system.
What are the critical questions or conversations that we're not having? Because I don't necessarily want to take the high moral ground, but we do have a phenomenon like umavuso. Yeah. On social media, you see people posting December, and we make light of it. What kind of message, what kind of a society are we developing?
Well, I think for me, there's a big issue of unemployment in this country. And it faces young girls in particular. If you look at the workplace, you look at stats in general, you find that the majority of the people who are unemployed becomes females. Most of them have got kids and brothers and sisters that they have to look after. So some of them, really, the socio-economic conditions that they find themselves in actually pushes them to these type of things that are happening, because the Mavuso thing simply means that you wake up in the morning and you ask money for that particular sexual favor. And in most cases, most of these guys that have got money, they decide whether to use condoms or not. So for me, let's deal decisively with the issue of unemployment with a biasness to the girl child. On many occasions, some of them, they've got university degrees. They still can't access jobs because they are told you need experience, you need this and that. We need a special dispensation that will support the girl child in this country.
But where's the decency?
It has to be balanced. Yeah. It has to be balanced, because it's one thing to acknowledge unemployment. It's another to acknowledge it as immorality. And we don't... hearing more and more voices, because as much as I have a young woman who's working at my house as a helper, it's a choice that she has made. And another young woman who then chooses to go and be part of Amavuso. It's a choice that they're making. But we're not hearing voices that are condemning immorality and calling it exactly what it is. We're not hearing voices that are celebrating young women, in spite of their difficulties and challenges, would opt out of making decisions and choices that are harmful to their health. And I truly believe that we need to begin to name things what they are and stop normalizing situations that are immoral. We're even celebrating people who use nakedness as part of fame. And for me, when I look at a nine-year-old looking at someone who's popular for walking around in nudity, because that is public indecency, what sort of motivation comes from seeing that?
And you're not referring to, you're not singling out Zodwa Wabantu, but
no person's name.
There has become a trend.
I mentioned no person's name. All I know is that those individuals are always, always on popular lists of celebrities that are going to be invited at popular events. And what then, a 10-year-old who's watching that, what are they supposed to learn? Mm. Is that, are those now our role models?
Yeah. Maybe from a clinical psychologist's point of view, how much of this kind of content and explicit images that young people see transcend into their adulthood in terms of the choices they make sexually?
That's a very tricky one. I must follow up on the normalization of promiscuity. I've just been following Twitter and Facebook around this thing yesterday that relationship ended. So I find it very problematic, because the implication is that of normalizing promiscuity and irresponsible sexual practices, that people then now see the justification of sleeping around and making sure that they make money out of those kind of things, and also getting involved in situations where they implicate themselves. At the same time, I hear a lot of focus around young girls and women. I'm of the view that also that we can also focus more on young boys in shaping them around their sexual understanding of sexual reproductive health. And one of the ways in which you can do that, it is through initiation schools and initiation practices where young boys are taught effective ways of engaging sexually. I'm much more aware of the Xhosa male traditional practice where young boys are taken to initiation schools, where one of the ways that is encouraged is for them to take responsive ways of engaging sexually. So in terms of gender differences, I don't want us to be focusing more on girls, but I also want us to focus more on what can be done to teach young boys to be responsive, because you would hear in most cases that women would say a condom should be brought by a man, whereas it is one problematic way that a man should not be the one who's responsible for that. Mm. The woman also could be responsible in making sure that they bring lubricants and making sure that they bring condoms, so as to find a possible way of negotiating the differences and making sure that they engage in good sexual practices.
Yeah, that's if the power dynamics are equal. Let's go to a caller. Olas, good evening to you, calling us from the Free State. Hello?
Hello.
Hi.
Hi, good day. All right, I would like to just share my view here. First of all, I do believe that the youngsters are actually getting involved because of the child grant. Isn't there a possibility that the government couldn't give them the money not to have children and not to have use condoms and having to use condoms and just, you know, they must just be protective themselves and look after themselves.
Yeah, Orpas, you and Tina seem to share the same sentiment, and I'm getting the sense that you're insinuating that the lack of condom use is largely amongst black people. I don't know the percentage of white girls on social grant, but are you insinuating that it's largely a black problem? Oh, okay, she's gone there. That's my sense, anyway.
If I can chip in quickly. Because I think it's, in my view, a very dangerous way of looking at things. Because it seeks to suggest that grants are purely to assist those who have children or they are just child support grants. In fact, the grant system of this country is one of the most, effective methods of trying to bridge, you know, the very dire poverty situation that we find ourselves in our country. But the real conversation that we need to have here, and I think we started very well, there needs to be a conversation in the home between the mother or the father and the child, whether boy or girl, to say, this is how we need to deal with issues of sex and so on and so forth. But at the same time, society as well. Because I heard Sis Criselda continuously talking about issues of morality and so on. Have we really agreed as a society what informs our collective morality? Because sometimes morality becomes subjective. You know, some people look at something like, for instance, you've used an example about an artist. Now, she can argue that what I'm doing is actually part of my craft. It's part of my art, you know. For instance, you find beauty contests where people actually go around with bikinis and so on. It's been there for ages. What we need to do is to agree as a society to say what forms part of our collective morality that we need to agree
but
on
to
as a country.
But to compare South Africa and Bantu,
you can't compare the two. Because when you are deliberately exposing what we regard as private parts, that's different from a person who's wearing swimwear. Because we're saying swimwear. And the things that are supposed to be under protected must be under and protected.
Absolutely.
Because in our environments, I mean, you look at your home. When you are at home, when you've just taken a bath, you just walk around in the house having...
He might be a nudist or an exhibitionist.
Let me just take to clarify that. Because most of the time we hide, we cover up. Yeah. And that's how our children are socialized.
Yeah.
They're socialized in a way that you cover up.
And okay, we'll take your comments, your closing comments in a bit, Mr. Mtsweni. We have to take our caller. Okay. Theo has been very patient, calling from East London or Eastern Cape. Good evening to you.
Hello, Alice. How are you?
Very well, thank you.
Thanks a lot, Dad. Thanks for the discussion. A very, very important discussion in our society. But I think also that one thing that I think we need to look at very much is the use of technology. Mostly in our society, we find ourselves thinking that once a young person is having access to mobiles and all that, it's only for basic things. It's not for enhancing their knowledge and all that. So the youth tend to use that mostly to things that are not worth it. Like, for instance, as what Christopher was saying, looking at celebrities and so on and so forth, which is not building society. So I think also the usage of social media and also mobile phones and so on needs to be looked at very much deeply in terms of how can we use that to advance our youth in terms of knowledge and understanding of what's happening around them, besides going to gossip and all the other things. Thanks a lot.
Well made, safeguarding your child against the onslaught of the cyberspace. Anela, very briefly, in your view, what else that we need to cover or what people need to look at in trying to... I suppose a remedy where the cracks or what has happened in society so far.
I think we need to relook our understanding of sexual reproductive health strategies in terms of fostering a different kind of knowledge systems and alternative preventative methods that are within the current ranges of what young people can relate with. And so in that way, we'll be finding other possibilities where other methods will help young people to engage in self-sex practices and challenge their conceptions of what it means to be engaging in intimacy and finding pleasure at the same time whilst engaging in protective sex. So basically, I really encourage to find a way of encouraging
To be comfortable with the subject, yeah, and, yes. and the pros and cons. Thanks so much, Anele Siswana, clinical psychologist. And very briefly, in terms of contact numbers, where we can go. But I do labor the point that cultures like intensity, konozolahla, or whatever it is, of women being plied with alcohol and being presented as prey.
We bat like guy,
you know?
Like I feel like young people are under siege because they're expected to make these informed decisions, and the information at their disposal has not empowered them. And we have not, as adults, stood up and say, this is what we regard as a collective moral ground. Where is moral generation as an organization? What do they stand for? Who do they serve? Where do they operate from? And because we have not had those conversations, it also needs us to begin to challenge parents. That when you are not parenting your children, someone else is. And that could be a cell phone, a television program, even print media is parenting your children. And what information informs their choices and decisions?
We're going to have to leave it there. Sincerely appreciated for your time. My Queen Griselda Dudumashe, media personality and wellness activist. You can catch her on How TV. She's also on Metro FM, Positive Talk. She's an author and an activist and a public speaker as well. We also had Mr. Sfiso Mtsweni, NYDA executive chairperson in studio. You at home, thanks indeed for watching. Do stay tuned. 8 and 7 is back after this.